Okay, we are live and ready to go with another chamber music session of the Really Big Class. It is Thursday, April 22nd. I had to look at the calendar there for confirmation. And because things are never as easy in Zoom land as we want them to be, after a flawless sound check, our first group has had a little bit of an internet bubble, but I think everything is back and set and ready to go, and I'm just excited to get started. We have three magnificent pieces of chamber music today. The first movement of Schubert's Death and the Maiden, the first movement of Dvorak's epic Opus 106, and the first movement of Beethoven's Opus 74 Harp Quartet. My quartets are from the UK and from Texas, from the Shepherd School of Music at Rice University. And I'm Cecily. I was a violinist in the Cyprus String Quartet for 20 years. These are all pieces that we played, performed, recorded, toured, lived with, and really spent a lot of time with. And so I'm very happy to be able to hear these groups play them today. I made a decision, rather than cutting these videos down to shorter 6 or 7 minutes, I'm going to play the complete movements. So each of these movements is about 10 minutes or more. So more of our class time today will be devoted to performance than usual. But there's a reason for that that I'll get to once we get to work. I think you'll understand why I wanted to do that. And let's get to it. So this is the Alchemy Quartet, a newly formed, born of the lockdown group from Manchester. The violinists, Caris and Emily, both are my students, and I'm really happy to see them playing together. It's wonderful. We also have Ellie and Anna, and they are in the concert hall at the Royal Northern College of Music. And we'll share the first movement of Schubert now. So this is the first movement of Death and the Maiden.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bravo. Well done. All right, is everything set on your end? You've got the internet back up and happy, and you can hear me and see me. I can see you. I've got you pinned. Fantastic. So, one of the greatest movements I think there is, from one of the greatest quartets there is. So, no pressure there. I want to first talk about some of the good, okay? So what do I really enjoy about your group's playing? Well, each one of you has a real voice, which is wonderful to hear. Anna, you're giving a really nice underpinning to the group without being overbearing. It's very, very good, sort of the bass, the way that you're holding the bass line in, which is really important in this piece. Ellie, triplet queen. So good, so clear, so clean. So getting run over by your colleagues some of the time. We're going to talk about that. But really, I mean, you're managing a very, very difficult and ungrateful part beautifully. So well done with that. Emily, you're there. You're like listening for everything all the time, which is great. I can tell that you're very like keenly in tune with what needs to be sort of put with who, and you're playing the second violinist role very well of tying the lower half to the treble. I mean that the middle voices, you've got a special role, and it's so important and vital. And Karis, you're doing a very good job of not being in the way, which sounds like a weird thing to say, but something that I will talk about, sort of what the role of the first violin is over the course of the class. That's something I want to talk about today. But you're doing a good job with not sort of steamrolling everything, which can easily happen because you have so many notes in this piece. So that those are all wonderful things. I can tell you love the piece. I can tell that you enjoy playing together. A lot of things are really nicely in tune. There's always work to be done with intonation in a quartet. We can talk about that, and we can talk about why it's important as well. There's so much that we could get into, but the things that I want to try to address in a very short amount of time are, first of all, how to play together a bit more easily so that things are actually really solidly together. Not close, not approximate, but as one. So that's one thing I want to talk about, and I can give you some ways to try that. I'd like to talk, and this is something that I hinted at in terms of these massive movements that each of the groups are playing today. I want to talk about sort of how to deal with structure in a way that makes that's not academic, although there has to be an academic understanding of the structure for it to come to life. But how really manipulating the structure of a movement can change the listening experience. That sounds kind of grandiose. I don't know if I'm going to actually be able to get that across to anybody, but it's something that I feel passionately about. And it's one of the things, like, when you're playing in a symphony orchestra and you're playing a symphony that has like a really large scale movement, like a piece by Mahler or one of the huge Beethoven symphonies or Brahms or anything that's just like more than 6 minutes long, right? One of the tasks of the conductor, hopefully, if they're any good, is to build an architecture to the performance that holds the listener's attention and leaves them hanging on whatever's going to happen next. You know that feeling? You've had that feeling, hopefully, in an ensemble. Hopefully, you've had that feeling listening to some piece of music where you're just being sort of pulled along inevitably on this ride, and you can't avoid it because it's so strong. Now, when you have, one person in charge of a massive group and they're doing a good job of that, it's one thing. But in a string quartet, you don't have that dictator showing you how it's going to work. And I don't say that in a derogatory way. I mean it in like someone who is dictating how the story's going to go. You don't have that. You have to come up with that as a group. But we also, as string quartets, have these large-scale movements to grapple with, whether it's Schubert or Beethoven or Dvorak or even Shostakovich. Sometimes the whole quartet is a single movement. And there are these big structures that, similar to a symphonic work, have to have tension held through them in such a way that the listener has a clue what's happening. Does that make any sense? So I want to talk about that and maybe try a few things. And what ends up happening is you build this massive structure out of little gestures. And it's the way that the small gestures hang together and lead to the next small gesture that creates the longer line. And that, I think, we can get at pretty readily in this movement. So that's point number two. And point number three is that I want to work on your listening and see if we can get your listening and your reaction times faster. And so I'm going to be a little bit demanding about that, because these other things won't come together unless your listening and reaction times are quicker and more sort of alive, and like you've got these crazy antennae out all the time for each other. Okay, so let's start from the beginning. I'm probably going to jump around rather than have you play long sections, because there are different things that'll demonstrate these different ideas better. But let's start at the beginning. I'd like you to play from bar one up to the first pause. So what is that, bar 12, something like that? 13? That was already better than your recording. And maybe, you know, having watched it back or knowing that you're not recording and it doesn't have to be the one you're sending off and you're just playing for the people in the room, much better. But let's focus in first on this idea of how can we play together more easily? Because there's a lot of unison gesture, unison playing in this movement and in quartet playing in general. You're often... sometimes there are four very distinct parts, but often at least two people are doing the same thing, if not more. So let's start with just the first two bars and tell me how you've worked on it. I know you've worked on it, so tell me what your methods have been.
We've tried a variety of different bowings, not just the one we started with the same one as we've settled upon, but we have tried others as well. And where to feel the beats, is it in four, is it in two, and like bouncing off the third crotchet beat for the retake and that sort of thing.
Good. So have you determined, which did you decide, in two or four?
Two, yeah.
Two. I missed that. Two? Two. You're in two. So you're, and are you feeling like one, two, one, kind of together? That sort of thing? And have you decided, I mean, there's going to be a bunch of questions. You've got two downbeats. Right, da, ya, da, da, dum. Are they equal? Or is one more than the other one?
First is more. We haven't really discussed it.
Ah, okay. So we'll discuss that. Are you lifting? You mentioned a retake. How are you getting to the triplet? Are you putting a space?
Horizontal.
Okay. And are you starting the triplet from the string or above the string? There's only one right answer there. You know what it is.
Sorry?
From the string, right? Okay, good. Now, have you tried having different people lead the gesture? And have you, it kind of seemed like you decided that Emily was leading it. Is that true? Great. Let's throw a wrench in the works and have Anna lead it. Just play the first two bars. Good. Try just that. And as so, one of the things that's going to make you play together more easily and have things come together more quickly is if you are super attentive to every detail. So if you let someone lead, but you're following, you're going to be late, right? So you have to lead together. You've discussed how you're going to breathe, I think. So while Anna's going to initiate that motion, the three of you are going to join her in it and not follow her. That's step number one, to join, not follow. Step number two, pay attention to where her bow is when she starts the note and match it precisely, not approximately. Try that. It should get worse before it gets better. Try it again. A little bit closer. Is she setting her bow on her string before she pulls the down bow? Or is it coming from above? Anna, you don't have to change. They have to notice. Did you hear that the start of that first note is much cleaner? But now you're not getting the release of the note, so the next triplet can't be together. So you have to pay attention to note beginnings and endings, not just the beginnings. Try again. That was awesome. Yeah? Really, really, really good. Ellie, your turn. All right. So now you're going to start to notice each other's body language, right? Is she quicker to the string or slower than Anna? Try again. The start of the note was really good, but did you hear the release again? Got kind of, eh. So the triplet wasn't together. They're related. Now let's go back to Emily. Keep all of those things and listen to the release of the final note. Perfection, right? And we don't need Cars to lead, because my goal as a former first violinist is to make sure that the first violinist never leads anything. This is enough to do. You don't need to lead. So make them do it. You all did it brilliantly, but now you're listening. Okay, so now, do you hear the difference? Do you feel the difference? So that's the difference between following someone and playing as one. So we want to play as one. Can you do it from the beginning again and go up back, all the way through the pause now, right? Whatever you've decided in terms of who's leading, continue with that pattern, but up the ante on the listening and the matching. Okay? I'm gonna get kind of riled up today. I can't help it. Now you sound like a quartet instead of four people who enjoy playing together. That's a good thing, right? It had a point of view, it had direction, and it was as one. So now let's add a few things. I hope you feel that. Can you feel that in the room? Is it more? It should be thrilling, actually. When you get that feeling, it takes it over. And like you stop worrying about whether you're going to get the right vibrato on a note and whether it's going to be in tune or not. You just are playing together and as one. So a couple more things. Now we're going to start talking about this idea of tension and holding the tension between phrases or little gestures. So I mentioned that, you know, the long line comes from building the gestures. This is so gestural, right? You have yum, ba 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 bum, it stops. There are a lot of ways to handle that rest. You can stop, you can da, ya da da da, relax. Ja, da 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 da, relax. That, it's viable. I wouldn't recommend it, but it's viable. You can do that. You can also have a feeling, and this is a little bit more of what you did, of shock that you've stopped. Of yawn, da 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 dum. Da, ya da da dum. Like, you know, it's up in the air. What are we going to do next? And then you start to lead. Ya pa pa pum. Ya da da team. And this is where I felt like you lost it. So the first two, the forte gestures were great. But ya da da dum. What does that rest do? What do you think? Is it a feeling of release or a feeling of suspense?
Suspense, yeah.
Right? So how do you get suspense to happen in a rest? You're not doing anything. So how do you make it feel suspenseful?
It's almost like following it through with your boat. Yeah. Like from a technical standpoint.
From a technical standpoint, it has everything to do with how you leave the note before the silence. So this is where I'm going to be picky again. Listen to your note endings. Because if da 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 dum, if that note doesn't end as one, you don't have the feeling of suspense leading to ya da da tum. It's not enough to start notes together. You have to finish them together too. All right, so that's job one. For keep everything you did in the first four bars. That was awesome. When you go on, add this feeling of how do we want to leave the notes before the rest to carry us over to the next thing. And also, because I want you to continue playing, where you go to the middle of bar seven, everyone changes, but not everyone changes pitch, correct? Who do we want to look to for the motion? Keeping in mind my rule that the first violinist should never lead. Anna. Okay, so from there, could you really take control of the line as if you're playing the melody? So you need to create the space for Cars to do something beautiful, right? You can't just say, okay, well, you're not leading anymore, so I'm going to do whatever. Good luck. Right? You have to play in such a way that you create, and this is something else that's so hard to put into words, but if you can find it, it's another one of these things that's just like, it's so addictive and thrilling. So if you can learn to play in a way where the accompanimental material or the harmonic material creates possibility for the melody so that you have in mind what she might want to do, and you make it possible for her to play exquisitely, right? It's such a great feeling. So that's all you have to do. All right, try.
From top.
So tell me about that.
I noticed that Anna holds the notes for longer, I think. Us two are normally like dying away in the long notes, but I think because Anna's line is more melodic, she like goes through them.
And what do you think that implies for your voices?
that we can go with her.
I think it would be good if you went with that. And that would also start to give us a little more sense of the harmony, which will help Karis come up with beautiful colors to play, because she'll be reacting to the chords underneath, because you're not going to let her forget what it was. Right? What else did you think? Revisit the first four bars. Were they as good?
The triplets seemed out.
They weren't quite as good as the time before. And I'm telling you, it's all about the way you leave the note before. It's all about that note ending. So you have to start to really get in tune with how you pick the bow up off the string as one. Good. Let's go on. And we're like already practically out of time. I'm so bad at time management with this stuff. But it's why quartets rehearse for, 4 hours, not 45 minutes. So as you go on with this, and this is something to think about through the movement, and if you're learning the rest of the piece, it is good for the whole thing, which is, how do you feel the rhythmic intent of the triplets when you're not playing them? And if you can do that, it will allow the people who do have to play the triplets to fit them in. So, have you rehearsed this part in pairs or only with everyone? You have. Can we do that really quickly? Could we just hear the lower half of the quartet from bar 15? Ask you to do that again. It's mostly together. It's not perfect. It could be perfect, and it will be. So could you try again? And when you're not playing the triplet, can you imagine that you are? So don't just listen to it, internalize it. Did you feel that start to come into sync a little bit better? There are a few places, and this is a great place to have the discussion. Is it in two? Is it in four? How do the beats relate? Are they like 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4? Like, how are you feeling it and counting it? You can discuss all that. Can we hear the violins now? So I would, if we had endless time, I would have one of you play triplets the whole time, and probably add everyone else in, and then have like trade around who's playing continual triplets and doing every game you can think of in terms of the rhythm. But I want to get across again this point of holding tension within the line. All right, so I'd like you to play it maybe 2/3 tempo. So slow down, imagine triplets all the time. And can you make one line out of what you just played? So just like you have this piece of elastic would be too stretchy, like something that's really hard to pull. And you're pulling it and pulling it and pulling it until the very end with no tension ever letting up. Actually, let's put everyone together because we're going to run out of time with that feeling. So about 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Thank you.
get the idea of what I'm talking about? It means, I don't know if I'm going to be able to show it with just one line. But, so if you're feeling... You're not... You're releasing the sound, but... As if you're thinking... Has this sort of seething energy that never lets up. Could you actually, this might be a disaster, but if it is, that's okay. I take responsibility. Can you all fill in all the triplets and play like a... Now play it for real. So I'm really stunned, but I have to stop because I promised this next group that I would get them on their way to their jabs. Do you get the idea, though?
Yes. Yeah.
So that's like a digest of the kind of work you could do in terms of really, really unifying your gestures and then creating these longer structures that don't have so much sort of this to them. It has a lot to do with deciding things, like even in the first two bars, is this first downbeat the same as the second downbeat, or is one stronger than the other? But having all of these things sort of pulled together, because you've got 11 and a half minutes to tell this story and keep everyone's attention. So they're like, what happened next? Right? It's great. And you're changing so quickly. So well done for that. Keep playing together, even if, you know, everything goes back to normal. And I'll see you all very soon in Manchester. But thank you for bringing us this amazing Schubert. And sorry to stop, but we've got Dvorak in the wings.
Thank you.
Bye, all. Okay, so we are going to flip, everything. And here, just really one of my favorite pieces of music written. This is Dvorak's Opus 106 Quartet. This is the Meraki Quartet from Texas. And... yeah, let's just get right to it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Fantastic. All right. You hear me okay?
Yes.
So, we're going to get right to it. Good things, really good things about your playing. You have sorted out how to pass off the lines. You've sorted out much of how to color the harmonies, which is so important in this piece and in this movement, to hear the different harmonies and to react to them as you're playing. What I think I could maybe, and I know you've performed the whole piece and you're probably moving on to new repertoire, but what I can maybe help you with is to gain a bit more of an understanding of possibilities of pacing. So what I was talking with the Schubert group about this idea of holding the tension in a line to guide the structure and the architecture of the piece is so important in a piece like this. And some people, I've heard people complain that, oh, Dvorak, you know, it's beautiful tunes, great melodies, but it's not that well written. Have people said that to you? Have you ever heard that?
Yes.
Yeah, I reject that outright. I hope you do too. I think it's up to us as performers to find the genius in the architecture and in the pacing and find a way to make it work. Now, I know we spoke briefly yesterday, and I think I've got... So my edition of this, the part that I played off of, is a supraphone. It's kind of like a Czech Baronreiter kind of thing. And then I have a Dover score in front of me. And I don't know if either of them are going to match what you're looking at. But I'm going to ask you to try some things that may not be what are in your part or may not be what you're used to doing, but it's what I'm looking at. And maybe it'll help. Okay. I feel like in Dvorak, I'm not a scholar. I don't have the sort of academic rigor that would be needed to say this with authority, but I've spent a lot of time playing Dvorak's music. And it's been my experience that if you actually take a more careful look at the markings that he put in and stay a little bit truer to them, it actually really helps. And so what I mean by that is accent what's accented. Don't accent what isn't accented. Make differences between forte and fortissimo. He uses every shade of dynamic where Beethoven might use piano forte and fortissimo and you don't see much in between. Dvorak takes us from triple piano. Is there a triple forte in this movement? If not, there's like fortissimo plus, right? So we have, and then everything in between, he writes mezzo piano, he writes mezzo forte, he gives us every kind of articulation. There's sforzandissimos, there's sforzando pianos, there are accents, there are hats, there are dots, everything that he can throw at the page, he does. So let's pick a section, and the part that kind of comes to my mind, I have to find it. I should have written it down as you were playing. Do you have rehearsal numbers?
Yes.
You have 7? It's a terrible place to make you start. But I think you'll understand why, right? So this is in the development as we're approaching the recap, right? And I'm sure that you know intellectually the sections of the and how the movement's constructed and it's not a Allegro form and where the themes are and everything. But so here we are. This is sort of our last big buildup before he releases us back to the recap, right? I'd like you to play from rehearsal 7 and stop at... Oh, there's no good place to stop. Play all the way to 10. So I'm going to have you play a big section. As you're playing, keep track of some things. So even if it's not what you've rehearsed, see if you can differentiate more between dynamics. Think a lot about where accents happen and if you're slamming your bow into the string where there shouldn't be an accent. And let's see how much of it you can just sort of do on the fly. So this is rehearsal 7 to 10. I lied. I'm going to stop you there. So what I would really like you to try now is thinking of that as one long unspooling. Okay, so you build from rehearsal 7. Where do you think the high point or the peak of, like, the utmost tension happens?
Do you have a measure number?
I do, yeah.
Around, like, 189 to 200 is when it starts to come down, or 201 is when it starts to come down.
So 201 is where the diminuendo is actually marked, right? Do you feel like, so you've got a, for those of you not looking at a score, what they're starting at is marked forte with a lot of stuff, and then it goes to fortissimo, and then fortissimo with a crescendo up, and then another fortissimo, and starting in bar 201 is where the diminuendo starts. So do you feel like from the fortissimo before that, that's what, bar 198, does tension continue to build to 201, or do you feel like 198
is the top?
And then does it plateau, or does it release a little bit before the diminuendo?
I think it releases a bit at 193.
Okay. Does everyone agree with that?
I think, well, musically, since it gets busier, maybe it's not that the tension releases, but it's just a different kind of tension because we're not all sustaining in the same way.
Okay. So whatever that means to you as a group, I want to hear that. But this is what I want you to do differently from what you've done so far. From 201, I would like you to take us all the way to that exquisite triple piano that happens in what 224? In one long, like, you've got a spool of thread, and that it doesn't unwind until there. And what you're doing currently is you're arriving at 8, at rehearsal 8. I want you to remove that arrival and just let it be part of the unwinding, which means don't take time. You're putting a big old accent there. There's no accent. It's mezzo piano and leggero after. And see if you can make that feel like, so one long buildup that plateaus a little bit, and then one long unwinding. Okay, try. Thank you for trying that. Is that radically different from anything you've done before in terms of what happened at 8?
I mean, it definitely felt like a much longer line now. Before, we were thinking a bit more chunks of different.
Yes. So part of what's challenging in this movement is that you have 4-bar chunks a lot of the time. And often the harmonic rhythm goes along with that. You have 4 bars in this harmony and then 4 bars in this harmony, and it kind of goes through and through, and each one has its own emotion, but you have to find ways to pull that all the way through. So I'd like you to try this again, and I'm sure you've done this in rehearsal, but just do it, especially because this is a piece that I think a lot of the people listening probably don't know that well. So we have the advantage. We know it inside and out. But let's take it, and could you, this is always interesting to ask a group to do, could you play only where you think you have primary material? So when you have the lead material, play same section, And the lead material is now going to create this long arc up, and then this sort of gentle unspooling down. And it might happen that two people play at once. That's always intriguing when that happens. I love it. So you've rehearsed it, you've figured it out, and we all think we're primary material. That's awesome. I think da-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum, bim-bom, ba-ba is our main character. So this moves from second violin to cello, right? Just because that part's loud and hard and beautiful, yeah, da 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 da. We don't care. That's not main. Da dum ba dum ba. Cello part, right? Da dum ba dum ba da. Cello part in thirds. Da dum da da yum ba. Viola part. Da dum ba dum bum ba. This is what I want to hear you pass off and build the tension through. Let's try that. You do get to play, Sophia. You get to play at where your thirds are. Yeah? That's you still. Maybe add the viola part. Beautiful. I'm not saying that the other parts aren't absolutely integral. And the other point I want to talk about is sort of Dvorak textures and how he manages to put something different in every single part. It's absolutely amazing, and no other composer does it like him. But I think if you can keep your ear on what just happened and lead the tension with it and let everything else sort of stir the pot around that, you'll get a better sense of long line. Now, I'm going to get on your case about a few things. Sorry. At the forte, I'm looking at a score that doesn't have measure numbers and my violin part that does. So I'm looking at right where the A octaves are on the violin. 198, our fantastic viola here. Could you play right there? And I just want you to think a lot about how you're accenting or not accenting. Fantastic. Did you hear that she sustained da-dum, ba-dum, but without going da-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum? That's awesome. Could we hear now at the cello version of the same thing? You know where that is? The fifth bar of 7. Good. So it has sort of a build without being too bouncy. That's going to let it be heard through da 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 through all the muck, right? There's a lot going on here. Now, let's skip ahead to 8. And Sophia, could I hear how you're playing this? It's gentle now. We're in mezzo piano. You've got thirds. I'm sorry. I'm going to make you play them alone. But could you just do that? That second one was better. Did you hear the first time you kind of accented with your bow? Could you play just the upper line as if it were the simplest thing in the world? And go ahead and release the second note, bottom, bottom. I'm gonna be a pain. Could you use your bow in a slightly more judicious way so that you're not wadum, wadum? You're not punching it with your bow, but you're spending so much bow quickly that it still has an accent. Good, put the thirds into that. Good. Now, you're a great violinist, so I know you can do this. Can you only slide if you mean it? Gorgeous. Good. Do you know why I asked you for that?
Because then the shift sounds technical instead of expressive.
What? And because it adds sort of a gooiness to the feeling of the phrase that I don't think you want. It was just because your fingers were sort of dragging on the string. It wasn't on purpose, and you're too good for that. So just call, and this is the kind of thing, like in rehearsal, and I haven't talked about this very much in the chamber music classes, about how to talk to each other in rehearsal. So there are times that, you know, you're acutely aware of something that you're doing that you don't prefer. It's not the way you mean to do it. And the last thing you want is for one of your colleagues to say, you know you're missing that shift, right? Because you know you're missing it. And so there are times when having things like that pointed out is not helpful. But at the same time, there are lots of places where we have no idea what we're doing. We don't know what's coming out. And if someone, there are times that, man, if one of my colleagues had said to me, you know, Cecily, every time you play the C on the D string in fourth position, it's a little bit sharp. Like if someone had said that to me about 5 years into my career as a violinist in a string quartet, it would have been life-changing, because it took me a long time to figure out that every time I heard a recording back, I was like, why is that C out of tune? It's like, because I put it in the wrong place for a long time. So there are things that if you point out to each other in a way that's, it's not a personal affront. It's, hey, I'm noticing that I hear this. Is that what you intend or not? There's no judgment there. It's just an awareness of, I'm hearing this. Are you hearing this? Do we all hear the same thing? Right? And I'm sure that you work together really beautifully, but I think it's worth saying, like me pointing out to you, you're dragging your fingers on that slide. If you paid attention to that 2 months ago when you first learned the part, that would have been a good thing, right? So just keep that in mind as you're rehearsing together, that you have the incredible opportunity of having four sets of ears on the same thing. And that's only more helpful than only your own set of ears. And it's something that I'm so longing for. I'm so tired of my own problems. I want someone else to, you know, because I'm sitting here playing alone in my loft. I would love to have someone else to say, you know, that shift isn't great. But anyway, that's just sort of an aside. One more thing, Sophia, for you. When you come to the place with the octave, the very end of this long unwinding, where you're playing the da-dum, body, bottom, body, underneath the octave, could you play, I'm sorry to make you play it alone, but could you play that part for me? Now, again, you are a very fine violinist and you can do this. Can you make the lower line have the same articulation with the bow and lilt da-dum, ba-dum, ba, that you had before, even though you're also sustaining an octave? Great. Now I'm going to ask you all to play right there. And before you do, I want you to tell me what kind of color you're thinking of for the triple piano that you're getting to.
Very pure and dolce and sweet.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Say that again.
The pure sound and very sweet. Very
sweet. Very, like, what kind of sweet? Like, how, if it's a flavor, what are you tasting? I can't hear you.
So sparkly sweet.
Sparkly, like, okay. So that's where you have to get to. In, and you've got four, you've had about 18 bars to do it, but right now you, where I'm giving you 4 bars to get us there. And could you be so brave and so daring with what you make out of that triple piano? Is it triple piano in your part?
Yes.
On the A flat major. So can you make it just the most exquisite, delicate, lacy texture? So probably about like a quarter the amount of sound that you've been making so far. Try. So there's some technical things here, and we're out of time, and our internet is also kind of fighting with us for a moment. So you're a little bit laggy, but can you use your bows to make this diminuendo the way that you would in a violin concerto or viola concerto or cello concerto? So what that means is as you come down the diminuendo, less bow, less bow, less bow, less bow, right? And when you set that color, the triple piano, this sparkly, sweet, exquisite gorgeousness, right? It's only 2 voices, right? It's just your inner voices. She's not going to cover you, June. She's going to play so just like gossamer around you. Don't lose the color, because this is something I found throughout your performance, is you'd take us somewhere, you'd make a diminuendo or a crescendo, and then you wouldn't deliver. So you'd get there and you'd either, like, especially coming down to small dynamics, you'd immediately bloom. And here we've got at least 6 bars before there's any reason to make more sound. In fact, you could make less. You can make it quieter and quieter. Could you try that? And then we'll call it a day. Did you feel that? I think those 6 bars, you can like play a quiet contest. Who can play it more exquisitely, more sweetly, more delicately? And then when you get to the E major, all you have to do is use a tiny bit of bow to get the sound kind of moving again. You don't have to work so hard. And that's where, so, you know, we talked about rehearsal 7 coming up to sort of a plateau, then bringing us all the way down to here, to the triple piano. Now we want to linger in this otherworldly quality for a little while and bloom out of it maybe a little more slowly, and then you have another big build, right? And that, we don't have time, but this is a place where I really want you to think about whether da-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum, ba is necessary. Or if we want da-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum, ba-dim, ba-da, to have a long, kind of like in the Schubert, if you have too many bounces, you're going to not climb, right? That's the kind of thing that is just super exciting in this movement. And anytime you're dealing with massive structures, to look for the absolute longest trajectory possible. In general, I think you could, if you were working this up for another performance, you could take a step back and reevaluate some of your timings and reevaluate some of your indulgences and make sure that you love them. Because you don't need to take time every four bars. Sometimes it's much more exciting to push through. A good example of that is at the very end. And, you know, the little coda where you have all of these stops. The ya-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-dum, dum, da-dum-fa-da, ya-da-da-da-da-da-da-dum, jum, da-dum-fa. If you go through it, then the Minimoso Maestoso has a different sort of gravity. Right. So it's always it's like a juggling act. You have to trust each other to take time and to be malleable. And then you have to say, okay, we're not going to do any of that. We're going to go through and make the longest line possible and drive through. And then maybe you'll find, oh, that driving doesn't feel good. We need to take more time. You know, the music needs time. But always going back and forth to find the architecture is exciting to work on. All right, so I'm going to let you go. I've gone over a little bit. I hope you still make the timing and get those shots in your arms. And thank you very much for playing in the role. Great to meet you or re-meet you. I think I met some of you in California, but you again, I'm sure.
Thank you.
All right. So I'm going to take a breath because now we're going to change gears and again, go back a few steps and hear some Beethoven. So our next performance is of the first movement of Beethoven's Opus 74, the harp. This is a group called the Caccini Quartet. And let's hear it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bravo, Abby. All right, let me get you here. So, tell me a little bit about what you think you need.
I think at this time, probably sometimes we struggle to get the good flow in the piece. We sort of have the bits and pieces, but sometimes when we play through, they just do not connect well with each other, and so the sort of, I don't know, overwhelming wave that needs to come at the end sounds at times a bit unjustified.
Okay.
Struggle to join things together at sort of arrival and transition points. So we've got quite a lot of sort of sections that we're quite like happy with, capture the thing, and then trying to tie them all together.
Okay.
And also sometimes I think we decide sometimes things that we need to do, but when it comes to playing them and actually delivering them, we just don't do it.
Okay. Isn't that I think that's universally true. We all have things that we think we want to do, and then in the end, maybe we don't quite do that. As a quartet, that's an interesting thing, because I think a lot of our rehearsal time is about coming together to like forming a group interpretation and a group feeling for a piece. That's why you form a quartet, so that you can do that as colleagues and sort of have your own stamp. And with Beethoven, certainly, like any quartet that intends to play together for any length of time, like you're gonna you need to have your way with Beethoven and let Beethoven have his way with you. I mean, you know, that it's like it's a relationship as a quartet with these pieces. And so, yeah, in rehearsal, we spend a lot of time talking about how we want things to go and how to make that happen. What we don't spend, and I think this is true of personal practice as well, what we don't spend enough time doing is exploring how things might go and exploring how to be okay with that and to actually enjoy that as a group, so that if someone takes a slightly different turn than you were expecting, you all react and roll with it and still end up at the same destination you were planning on. You just took a slightly different route. So that'll come. I mean, you haven't played together all that long. I mean, but you need to spend time in your rehearsal coming up with choices and not necessarily making a final decision. And then learning to trust each other in performance to listen and be on the ball and be okay with that and not come to rehearsal the next day and say, what were you thinking? That was the wrong tempo, right? I think we've all experienced that in rehearsals where, you know, you come in and something didn't go the way you wanted it to and someone's really upset about it. And there's a point somewhere between that and saying, well, okay, that didn't quite go as we intended, but this, and this happened. And then you try again. That's actually one of the great pleasures of playing in a set ensemble, is that you can see, you know, this is how Opus 74 went today, and tomorrow it's going to go like this. And having the opportunity and the privilege of revisiting pieces again and again is something that's very different than, you know, student days where you learn something, play it once, and never see it again, right? So I think what we can talk about, or what I'd like to talk about first, is just to explore a little bit how you listen to each other. And this is, anyone who's worked with me or seen me do a class, this is sort of one of my tricks of the trade. But I think it's worth doing. So could we start I think I don't want to start at the beginning. We'll go back to the beginning. But I want you to play something more active first. So could we play... I'll just play from the Allegro. I'm going to give you some assignments before you play. So, I'd like you to listen down one voice. So listen, first violin, listen to second violin to viola, viola to cello. And let's just do that first. Play the first, from the Allegro to bar 35. Okay, we're going to do that a bunch of times. So could you hear the person that I asked you to listen to at all times? Yeah? Let's switch then, if you could hear them just fine. Now listen to the person above you. So first violin to cello. Did you hear that person?
That was a bit harder.
That's more difficult for you. Okay, let's do that again. But now, and are you playing a little faster than you intend to? You a little nervous playing a little too fast? This is faster than your performance was.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's chill a little, just a tiny bit. You will have to play those 16th notes eventually. The semiquavers are coming on the next page. So just take a breath. Still listen to the person above you, the voice above you, while actively feeling like you're playing to the person below you. Now, this is not something you can actually do. It's just a mental trick. But it's putting your ears on one person and feeling like you're connecting to another person. Okay, wait, did you feel you were able to do that? Could you kind of split your... It's a little bit of a mental game to split your attention like that. All right, now we're going to try a bunch of different things until we find the thing that I'm experimenting. I'm looking for the thing that clicks for you. Could you all listen to your wonderful violist? So having a single focus changed something. Did you feel that as a group? All right, good. Let's stick with that. And I'm going to ask our outer voices to sit out for a second. And I just want Clara and Joanna to play. And outer voices, I want you to really, really actively imagine your parts as they're playing. Maybe even finger with your left hand, but no bow. But listen, picking one of the other of them to listen, like put all of your energy into listening to them. All right, now let's do the opposite. Let's have outer voices play and inner voices do the same thing. Play with your left hand, but listen, really choose one of your colleagues to listen to. Let's put it all back together now. Good. What did that feel like as you were playing?
Felt like I was more aware of everyone's part.
Could you feel Clara's part within yours?
Yes, more than before.
More than before. So that's something I think for you, Esther, it would be really great throughout this movement. If you can find a way to link in, I mean, she happens to have the most moving notes right there. So, but if you can link into the way that that feels and let that fill in your part, I think that'll really help you. What else did you notice as you played that time?
I felt like I was aware of how we were all directing the shape. And so things like when I take over the melody, I always felt like I had a lot of pressure to do the crescendo and things, but actually listening to how all the voices open out, it felt like it was going to happen anyway. I knew that everyone was doing the same thing.
Fantastic. That's exactly what I want you to feel like. And this is a very different kind of motion than in the Schubert Death and the Maiden, but it's a similar goal, which is to play as one, even though all of your parts are sort of moving in a different sort of way. Now, can you tell me the room that you're in? I'm on the computer, on the sofa. What is sort of up above me? Is there a wall, bookshelf, anything back there?
There's a big door, glass door, and a wall.
Glass door, okay. Could you now play the same way that you just played? You're in a small space, a tight space, but I want you to imagine now that you've now created this group feeling that is now going to sort of like spin out and go shoot out all together. And like, I like to use focal points. I don't know if you ever do this in your work. I have all kinds of little doodads in my music studio. This is one of my favorites. I have tons of them, but like, I want you to imagine this is like my little Buddha on a cell phone that, you know, you've got something way up behind me and high. It's important that it's high. Like, don't play down, play up, that you're sending this group feeling out to. Now that there was maybe a little wrench thrown in the works there, but that should feel freeing in a way, because it should make you feel like you're sort of going out this way instead of so much in your heads, right? I felt like a lot of what you did in your performance was very beautiful, but I felt very caught up in the work of it all. Do you know what I mean by that? Like, and this is a piece that I have spent, I can't even tell you how many hours practicing, rehearsing, performing. It's something that my quartet played very early on. We did it in competitions, which I wouldn't recommend, because it just puts a microscope onto it in a way that can feel kind of destructive. And there's so much difficulty, like sort of quartet craft difficulty in this movement. Everything from, you know, the opening, which needs to feel like everyone's just moving seamlessly together in without any effort, to bursting into this joy of the allegro, to, I'm sure it's a passage you've worked with more than you want to say, da, yeah, da, 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 to play that silly figure together. I mean, every quartet that plays this piece struggles with that, to get the release just right and the vibrato just right, and then yeah, da, 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 every single note together. Even the that has to happen while the pizzicato happened. Like, you can drive yourself, and I have driven myself absolutely crazy with all of these things. And they're incredibly important. It's so important that the ensemble comes together in a crystalline way, because it's what casts light on everything else. And this movement is so much about brightness and light. I think you agree. I mean, it's got some dark stuff too, but, you know, the overwhelming feeling is exuberance and joy, right? All right, so let's go back to the beginning now. And I want you to keep listening this way. And I think picking a single focal point is maybe, I usually like the sort of chain reaction thing, But I think you guys reacted so well to a single point. So do you want to pick one of you? It doesn't matter. Although I would say maybe not Esther. Let's again, like, we take the pressure off the first violinist. Don't make them lead. Just, you know, they're all in their heads anyway. Someone else. So, yeah? Okay. Okay, I'm going to stop you. How did that feel, playing?
Good. Yeah. For me, the focus on Ada slipped after bar four, I think.
Okay, sometimes you have to tell yourself, cello, 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 cello. Or we could do something where you actually just shift your attention every bar and make sure you're listening to someone other than yourself. But let's keep it simple for now. Let's stick to Ada. Am I saying that right?
Yeah.
Okay. But I want you to also now, when you're thinking to play with someone, we talked a little bit about this in the Schubert, about the idea of joining rather than following, and breathing together with rather than making, you know, solely the responsibility of the person leading. But here's another question. When you're thinking to play, actively play with someone, what do you look at? Because we use our eyes, right? I mean, we have to. So in addition to our ears. So what do you look at?
The bow. Yeah, mainly
the bow.
The bow. Could I challenge you to change that? We'll do that too, but I'd like you to look at her left hand. Okay, let's just do that. Do that one more time. Okay, so I'd like you to think that your left hand, actually the way that you put your fingers down, is not only showing the placement of the note, but the feeling of the note. So you're playing as expressively with your left hands as you are with your bows. Okay, let's take the bow out of it. Just do left hands. Ah, you never do that though. You're not gonna go plonk. Good. Now just two of you use your bows. I don't mind who. Good. Now everyone with the bow. Great. Do you feel how different that is?
Yes.
So part of the reason that it's a little bit challenging is because the cello motion is stepwise, right? The violin motion has this beautiful expressive leap, dee-yaw, dee-yaw, that you have to feel in the left hand. And the inner voice is... second violin, I wasn't remembering correctly. You change note, but it's not nearly as expressive a leap. And you change bow, correct? Where the outer voices don't, right? And viola doesn't change note at all, right? Dum, ba, da, da, after, until the slur. So that makes it a little bit hard to go with the left hand. So now that you've got your left hands a little bit more in sync, let's focus back on the bow. And I want you to match everything from distance from the bridge, depth into the string? Does she start on the string and pull? Does she come from above? Does it have a fast start? Does it have a slow? Every single thing about the bow. Great, except, is it legato between da, ya, dom, or is she putting a stop in her bow? I may not be hearing things correctly because of Zoom, but to my ear, Ada's playing with it with more legato between da, ya, than Esther, than you are. Yours feels a little bit portato, and then it's challenging because Clara has a stop, but can you kind of make it as if it, I mean, it's more of a pulse than a stop? Try one more time. Almost perfect. Didn't quite move together on the quaver. And wait. You're too eager. Now I want you to finish the note together as well. Perfection. Do you feel that? Like, that's so good. And similar to the Schubert, the way that you leave that note, the unification of the note ending creates the suspense in the rest that allows a continuity to the next bar. Now, if you don't want it to continue, it would be absolutely valid to play something like like a real stop, and then start again. That would be a musical idea that absolutely could be explored. But what it seemed like you were going for had more of a... So that it can... That you sort of have this feeling of... And then release to the next thing. Okay, so that took 3 minutes or so to fully explore how to get 5 beats together. That's not that long. 3 minutes, that's quick. So then the next step is to pick someone else. So let's do that. Let's do Clara. So what do you, let's do left hand first, although it's going to be tricky because she doesn't change note as much.
Playing with the bow just...
Yeah, let's try to combine it. So play with the bow, but focus on left hand. Okay, I can't quite see her left hand, but it wasn't together. So try it again. It's really hard when you don't change note. Let's go with her bow now. And then, so you're, okay. I interrupted too soon. The ending was good, but the note beginning of the final note wasn't together. That's fine. Let's switch to Esther, so you get to lead it. Good. Let's talk a little bit about gesture and about how to get the quartet going. So I asked you to lead, and immediately you moved differently than you did than when you were joining your colleagues. So why? Why do we do that? We suddenly are like, oh, gotta do this. You don't need to do that. Breathe the way that you want to breathe. Keep your violin nice and stable. Let the initiation of the bow on the string, combined with the feeling of your breath, show them where to play. Great. Now close your eyes and do it. Close your eyes and imagine that your hands are moving together. Okay, now open your eyes, pick someone to watch, and play to my funny little Buddha man back here. Oh, we missed the final quaver. But all of these things are actually more convincing to me than what you did initially. So, and what I'm trying to open up is like, how could you just try a bunch of things in rehearsal to find your way and at the same time be more comfortable playing with each other and a little bit less in your heads? Okay? I want to talk about two other spots before we call it a night. The first is the big dramatic development, where we've got the crazy inner voice stuff and dum ba bum ba ba. Tell me how you've worked on this section.
We've done in pairs, inner voices and external voices,
outer voices.
We've done without the quavers.
Okay. Have you done what we used to call cross pairs? So rather than like playing with like, doing the opposite. So second violin and cello, viola and first violin?
I think we did that, but a long time ago.
Yeah.
Okay. That's always worth exploring. Like, put the like pairs together and also the unlike elements while with two people listening. And the listeners have to be very attentive to what they're hearing, to be helpful, and then also internalize what you're hearing and do it yourself, right? The thing that I find really helpful in this particular passage is we tend to be very focused on the first parts of the bars, right? I need to look at it and not just start singing. Dun 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 bum ba bum ba bum bim pa. We're focused on the downbeats, and when the outer voice, when you're done, dun ding ding ba bim ba bi, we trade off these things and always thinking about one. Same thing with the da 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 da, like getting that continuous. It tends to work beats 1, 2, 3, 4, but beat 4 doesn't bring us back to beat 1. So I don't know if this makes any sense to you, but can we look at bar 109? Could you play bar 109 to bar 119? We'll just do part of it and just play it first. Okay, so I can tell that you're actually actively thinking to connect, in this particular part, as viola connects to second violin, viola connects to second violin, right? And first violin connects to cello, first violin connects to cello. Can you now offset it by half a bar? So instead of thinking so much about beats 1, 2, 3, 4, think about beats 3, 4, 1, 2. Good. I could really feel the inner voices getting that. And you feel the change in that. So it means that there's not a gap at the end of every bar anymore. Outer voices, it's actually harder for us to do that. But it's as like if the bottom note of the cello can kind of launch back up to the first violin. So deem, bumpeem, bumpeem, bumpy. Could the two of you just try that? Good. As you got softer, it worked better. It's harder in the lab dynamics. But that will actually transform that passage and make it feel less like bar, 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 and more like 10 bars, which is what we want, right? The other thing that I'm going to just suggest to you for the outer voices, you don't have to do all of it down, up, down, up, down, up, down. There are ways to kind of hook bowings here. I wouldn't do all of it hooked. And you may end up coming back to doing the bowing that you're doing now. But to think about, I'm going to play slowly so it doesn't sound like garbage. But so you've got then a rest. Are there these rests every once in a while? So rest. Rest. And you don't want to take time for those rests. But I think you can do. Or something to get your head out of this. And then if you throw it out in the end and do the same bowing, that's fine. But you've explored this other way of doing it, right? So that was one point I wanted to make to you. Same thing in the pizzicato passage. I feel you passing it to the next person, but then it's not connecting back down to the bottom. So if you've got bum, bum, beam, bum, 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 beam, bum, ba, ba, ba. See, so the turnaround from the straight quarters to the triplets, and then the triplets to the quavers, and the quavers to the faster triplets, you know, so that you're always handing it back. So that there's not a gap between every, and this is just from experience, that just happens. That we get to the top and we go. And maybe that's cool for one of them. But I think, especially if you're talking about wanting to sort of ride this wave through all of it, that's one of the things that can disrupt it. And the last thing that I'll say before we stop is about the big climax and this sort of joyous exuberance of arpeggiation while your colleagues get to play a gorgeous melody. This is easy for me to say and really hard to do. If you can find a way to get your shoulders back and your head up and play like it's the easiest thing in the world until you start to change keys. So I'll say this another way. What do the arpeggios add to the feeling of the music?
Suspense, momentum,
excitement, movement.
And does that stay consistent through all of them, or does it change?
It gives harmonic direction to us.
Yeah.
So as you're practicing, Esther, and as you look at this part, think about how I like to really simplify things. So to me, diminished arpeggios always mean trouble. It's trouble or mystery or disturbance in the force, right? So you've got this to start, then it goes up. So you're still in that sort of troubled land, and then the important thing about that is that you're not letting it go, right? It's not, we don't care about every note, you're just here. Then, and you just hold it, hold it, hold it, hold it, and then. And as soon as you get off that diminished arpeggio, and I'm playing like crap, but as soon as you get off that, it's like you're free. You're free to just sort of explore these gorgeous chords and listen. You actually get to listen to your colleagues playing this amazing melody. When you get to this, it just doesn't really matter. This matters. That's what matters. So gain a little bit of perspective.
Okay. Yeah.
About the kind of energy you're adding, mm-hmm. and what's really important about it. You can play it just fine, but you're tied up in knots about it, partly because you're trying to play it too fast and partly because you're trying to play it too loud. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I think you can back off the tempo, you can back off the dynamic, and enjoy listening. See if you can enjoy listening while you play it.
Right.
I can say that. I've maybe managed to do that twice in my life, but it's a good goal.
Okay.
Okay? One more thing. The end of this movement. What do you think the feeling is? And I'm talking about after you get the trumpet part. From there. What's the feeling?
Quite funny.
Yeah, ironic.
Hilarious, right?
Yeah.
Can you... I want you to let's finish off with playing this. So play from here. So after she's... And can you make me believe that you think this is just the goofiest thing that Beethoven could ever have written? Rehearse this, and as you think about it, be brave. So, and the way to get this together is to all have you on the string for and match bows like we did the other stuff. But once you hit this, there's no rush to start this. So you can let it sit. Let them sit on that chord. Let them wonder if you're going to come in. So, oh, then do this. Same thing. She's left there on this third, right? And the viola part. Then. And you don't have to stick to that, but you have to try it. So you have to explore, like, how, if you think it's ironic, like, how sort of off kilter can it be? Then you could also try it, like, how straight is it? Funnier if it's, sometimes things are much more cheeky if they're absolutely straight. But find your way with the timing so that it doesn't feel so studied at the end of this. All right, and then that sets off the beauty of the second movement even more, so because the second is probably one of the most exquisite things Beethoven wrote, coming right after this. So it's an extraordinary piece. It's got its quirks, but it's, thank you very much for bringing it, and I hope that helped.
Thank you.
Great. I've gone over, but it's Beethoven's fault, as always. Thank you very much to everyone who's been in on YouTube and those of you who are in the room. Does anyone have any questions before we call it an evening? I'm happy to answer any. Probably aren't any. Hi. No. So this is probably the last straight up ordinary really big class. I'm taking next week off because I have a lot to organize for May. May is New Music Month. I have four amazing composers who are going to join me. And I'll be taking one of the classes, and three of my wonderful violinist colleagues will be coming as well, for one each week. We will be exploring the music of Sally Beamish, Elena Ruhr, Clifton, I've forgotten his surname, and Moritz Eggert, and Clifton Ingram. And we'll also be looking at some established repertoire through the eyes of these wonderful composers. So we'll be having some Bach, some Debussy, some Brahms, and also some incredible new music that I had never heard that these wonderful performers are bringing. So it's going to be quite a month, different change of pace from the really big class, and then we'll see what the summer brings, but hopefully it'll bring lots of in-person performances and playing, and the need for Zoom masterclasses will diminish, but we'll just take it as it comes. And thank you very much to everyone who made tonight, this afternoon, possible. Shout out to Norm Fisher at Rice University, who changed my life when I was 15 years old at the Tanglewood School, Tanglewood Quartet Program. And I think that's it. We'll end the live stream.
Thank you so much. Everyone sounded so great. Thank you so much for your feedback.
Thank you.
Thank you.